Hi, this is Gio, and I'm back with a new video. It's class number 8 of the course on Signals and Systems from Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona. For more information, you can check out my webpage or get in touch via email. In the last class, we learned the important relationship between convolution in time domain and multiplication in frequency domain. This allowed us to study the behavior of LTI systems through their frequency response h of j omega, if you recall. Today, we will learn and make use of a dual property, which is that multiplication in time domain corresponds to convolution in frequency domain. So let's get started with the multiplication property. The convolution property, if you recall, states that convolution in time domain corresponds to multiplication in the frequency domain. That means that if your signal y of t is constructed as the convolution between h of t and x of t, where for example h of t is the impulse response of a system and x of t is its input, then the Fourier transform of y of t, the output, is given by the simple product between the respective Fourier transforms of h and x, which we denote as h of j omega, which is called the frequency response of the system, and x of j omega. Now, as I mentioned, the converse holds, so a dual property is established, which states that if a signal r of t is constructed as the product between s of t and p of t, then the Fourier transform of r of j omega is obtained as 1 over 2 pi times the convolution between the Fourier transforms s of j omega and r of j omega. And the same thing can be obviously written in the form of an integral by writing out the definition of convolution, which would be 1 over 2 pi, the integral of s of j theta, where theta is a mute variable, p of j omega minus theta d theta. So because of duality between time and frequency domains, we have the multiplication in time domain corresponds to convolution in the frequency domain. Such multiplication property has important applications, for example, in communication systems when performing modulation. Modulation is a multiplication of signals in time domain. Let's see an example. So as you see in this slide, let's assume that a certain signal s of t has a spectrum or a Fourier transform s of j omega as the one depicted at the top right of this slide. So this Fourier transform is non-zero between minus omega 1 and omega 1, and it's zero elsewhere, and it has some amplitude a at the origin, the peak amplitude. Now let's consider another signal p of t, which is cosine of omega 0 t. It's just a cosine signal. If you recall, the Fourier transform of P of j omega would be given by two Dirac impulses centered at frequencies plus omega 0 and minus omega 0. To be precise, would be given by pi delta of omega minus omega 0 plus pi delta of omega plus omega 0. So now let's assume that we're constructing the signal R of t given by the product between S of t and P of t. Okay, so the Fourier transform of R of t, R of j omega, would be given because of the multiplication property by 1 over 2 pi times the convolution of the respective Fourier transforms. So S of j omega, convolution P of j omega. Now, the result of such operation would be two replicas of the spectrum S of j omega centered at frequencies plus and minus omega 0. That's because when you operate the convolution between a certain signal and a Dirac impulse, the effect is the one of shifting the original signal by a quantity determined by the place where the impulse is centered. So in a nutshell, what we get is 1 over 2 s of j omega minus omega 0, which is one replica of the spectrum s, plus 1 over 2 s of j omega plus omega 0, which is another replica of s. So these two replicas are centered respectively at plus omega 0 and minus omega 0. We see this depicted in the figure at the bottom right of the slide. So what's interesting to notice here is that the information of the original signal S of j omega is preserved, but it has been shifted at higher frequencies, as frequencies omega 0, where omega 0 is larger than omega 1. Omega 1 was the maximum frequency of the original signal. Omega 0 is what we would call in communications the carrier the carrier frequency. We will see this in more details. So since the information has been preserved, it is interesting to wonder how to recover such information from the signal R of j omega. Information can be recovered through a process called demodulation. So what we saw before was an example of modulation. In the case of demodulation, we take the same R of t or R of j omega depicted at the top right of this slide, and what we do is simply multiplying again by p of t, by the same p of t that we used before. So again, on this slide you see depicted the Fourier transform of p of t, to recall that it's given by two Dirac deltas, again centered at omega 0 and minus omega 0, because p of t was a cosine signal. What we obtain is a signal that we call g of t, given by r of t plus times p of t. So because of the multiplication property, again, the Fourier transform of g of t will be given by 1 over 2 pi times the convolution between r of j omega and p of j omega. And you see g of j omega represented at the bottom right of this slide. So given r, which is here at the top, we are creating, by multiplying by p of t, two replicas of r of j omega shifted by frequencies plus and minus omega 0. And the result is three signals, because the part of the spectrum of r which was centered at omega 0 is replicated at 2 omega 0 and at 0, whereas the one on the left, centered at minus omega 0, would be replicated at minus 2 omega 0 and at 0. There are two replicas at 0 that sum up and give you the central part of the spectrum of g with amplitude a over 2. And then there's two extra replicas at double the frequencies, 2 omega 0 and minus 2 omega 0, with amplitude a over 4. So this is the result of such demodulation. And the interesting part is that it is possible to recover the original signal by using a low-pass filter. In fact, if you apply a low-pass filter on g of j omega, you will recover the central part and you would cut off the replicas at high frequencies, 2 omega 0. This will be seen in greater detail when we will study communication systems. But the take here is that the multiplication property has very important implications when we do multiplications of signals, such as in the case of modulation and demodulation. There are other cases indeed when the multiplication property can be useful. For example, if we want to calculate the Fourier transform of a certain signal that is rather complicated. So take for example the signal x of t in this slide. It's given by sine t times sine half t over pi t squared, right? Calculating the Fourier transform of such signal through the definition can be actually complicated. But we could notice that such signal can be decomposed into the product of two signals, apart from a coefficient pi. And these two signals are the sine of t over pi t and the sine of half t over pi t. So the interesting part here is that because x is given by the multiplication of two signals, the Fourier transform of x is going to be by the convolution of the Fourier transforms of these two signals. And we actually know the Fourier transforms of these two signals because we have encountered them previously. We know that the Fourier transform of a sinc function is a rectangular pulse. Therefore, one can obtain x of j omega as the convolution between the Fourier transform of the first sinc and the Fourier transform of the second sinc. The factor 1 over 2 is given by the product between 1 over 2 pi in the formula of the multiplication property times pi, which was present in the original signal x of t. So when you do the convolution of two rectangular pulses, what you obtain is a shape as the one showed in the figure on this slide for x of j omega. particularly important class of continuous time LTI systems is those for which the input and output satisfy a linear constant coefficient differential equation. So now we will learn how to determine the frequency response of such LTI systems. We will use some of the properties that we have learned in the last couple of classes. So consider a generic differential equation as the one shown on this slide at the top. You have a linear combination of derivatives of y of t of different orders, where y of t is the output of the system. And on the right hand side, you have a linear combination of derivatives of x of t, the input to the system of different orders. And the coefficients of such linear combinations are constant. That's why this is constant coefficient differential equation. Imagine that we want to study the behavior of such system. So imagine that we want to determine the frequency response h of j omega, because that would tell us everything about the LTI system. To do so, we calculate the Fourier transform of both sides of the equation. So what we obtain is that, first of all, because of the linearity property of the Fourier transform, the Fourier operator can be brought inside the sum. So the Fourier transform of a linear combination would be the linear combination of the Fourier transforms, and that's how we go from the first to the second line. And finally, because of the differentiation property that we have learned about, the Fourier transform of derivatives of several orders of a certain signal can be obtained as the product between j omega, as many times as the order of the derivative, times the Fourier transform of the non-differentiated signal. So to sum it up, we obtained that the sum of ak times j omega to the power of k y of j omega is equal to the sum of bk j omega to the power of k x of j omega. Once we had that expression, well, it's easy to obtain h of j omega as the ratio between y and x of j omega, so the ratio between the Fourier transforms of the output and the input. And in that case, what we obtain is a ratio of polynomials in the variable j omega. So let's see some examples to clarify how such powerful tool can be employed to study LTI systems. The first example is rather simple. It's just a first order system described by the following differential equation: dy of t in dt plus ay of t equal x of t for a certain positive a. If we calculate the Fourier transform of both sides of this equation, we obtain j omega y of j omega, because it's a derivative, plus ay of j omega, simply with a linear coefficient a, equal x of j omega, which is the Fourier transform of the input. Great. Then h of j omega, the frequency response of the system, again can be calculated easily from the ratio between y and x of j omega, and it will be given by 1 over j omega plus a. And we know that the anti-transform of such term, 1 over j omega plus a, because we have already encountered it, is given by h of t equal e to minus a t u of t. So by simply calculating the Fourier transform and by knowing the properties of the Fourier transform, we are able to obtain the impulse response of a system which was described by a differential equation. Obviously, we can do the same thing on more complicated systems. For example, in this slide, we consider a second order system, which is described by the differential equation: the second derivative of y plus 4, the first derivative of y plus 3y equals the derivative of x plus 2x. So we operate in a very similar manner. We calculate the Fourier transform of left and right hand side of the equation. We obtain terms in y of j omega and x of j omega, and then we calculate the ratio between y and x, and therefore we obtain h of j omega as given in this slide. So it's j omega plus 2 over j omega squared plus 4 j omega plus 3. So to further proceed, we manipulate this ratio of polynomials by factorizing the denominator. So we obtain g omega plus 2 over g omega plus 1 times g omega plus 3. Now recall that it's very useful to use a partial fraction expansion of this form, and to do so we need to obtain two coefficients, and we can write the same ratio of polynomial as 1/2 over g omega plus 1 plus 1/2 over g omega plus 3, where 1/2 and 1/2 are the two coefficients that we can obtain from a system of equations. Now it's really easy to anti-transform h of j omega, because these two simple terms have well-known anti-Fourier transform, and we obtain 1/2 e to minus t u of t plus 1/2 e to minus 3 t u of t. So then again, we have determined the impulse response given the differential equation that describes our system. Now let's assume that we know the input applied to exactly the same system, and that such input is x of t equal e to minus t u of t. The question is, what is y of t? What is the output of the system that corresponds to such input? So again, we know h of j omega, so we can simply calculate x of j omega, and by multiplying these two, we would obtain y of j omega. This is what we're doing in this slide. So h of j omega, again, is easy. It's the Fourier transform of x of t, and it can be simply multiplied by h of j omega. So x of j omega is 1 over j omega plus 1. When we multiply it by h of j omega, we obtain the expression on the second line. So we obtain j omega plus 2 over j omega plus 1 square now times j omega plus 3. Again, what we need to do now is decompose with a partial fraction expansion this ratio of polynomials. Notice that because we have a term of the second order, we will now need three coefficients to be able to express such ratio of polynomials. And that's why you see that after a few manipulations, we obtain 1 over 4 over j omega plus 1 plus 1 over 2 over j omega plus 1 square minus 1 over 4 over j omega plus 3. So we need three coefficients. One coefficient, which is 1 over 4 for the term j omega plus 1 of the first order. Then we need a second coefficient for the term j omega plus 1 of the second order. Such coefficient turns out to be 1/2. Then we need a third coefficient for the term j omega plus 3, which is of the first order. Such coefficient turns out to be minus 1/4. Cool. Once we have y in this simple form, then we can anti-transform each of the three terms one by one and obtain 1/4 e minus t u of t, 1/2 t e minus t u of t, and minus 1/4 e minus 3 t u of t, where the second term, 1/2 t e minus t u of t, is determined by leveraging the property of differentiation in the frequency domain, as we have seen in a previous example. Because we have a term of the second order with the denominator given by j omega plus 1 squared, so we use the differentiation property to obtain its anti-Fourier transform. So I would say there are two main takeaways from today's class. The first one is the important relationship between multiplication in time domain and convolution in frequency domain, which is the dual of what we had seen in the previous class. The second one is that we can easily study LTI systems characterized by linear constant coefficient differential equations in the Fourier transform domain. So in the next video, we will make use of the tools we learned so far to analyze the behavior of first order systems. See you soon.